Welcome, everyone. I was getting a little excited, sorry. Chair's prerogative. So welcome to the October 19th, 2016 DRCOG board meeting. We were a little worried about turnout tonight because of the presidential debate. I was kind of happy I had a DRCOG meeting, so I'd have a reason not to watch it. So we won't rush through the meeting like we normally do. So if I could have everyone stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Eva Henry, Jan Pawlowski, Bill Holland, Nancy Sharp, Elise Jones,
here.
David Beacom,
here.
Tim Mock, Chrissy Fanganello, Anthony Graves,
here.
Robin Kneach,
here.
Roger Partridge,
here.
Gail Watson, Don Rozier, Libby Szabo, Bob Pfeiffer,
here.
Bob Roth,
here.
Larry Vittem,
here.
David Spellman, Aaron Brockett,
here.
Ann Justin,
here.
Lynn Baca,
here.
George Teal, Paul Donahue, Doris Trular, Carrie Penaloza, Ron Engels, Catherine Hyder, Laura Christman, Richard Champion, Gail Christie, Rick Teeter, Debbie Nasta, Steve Conklin,
here.
Joe Jefferson,
here.
Jeff Deacon, Mark Gruber, Daniel Dick,
present.
Lisa Jones, Laura Brown, Lynette Kelsey,
here.
Scott Norquist, Storm Glore, Saoirse Karras-Grace,
here.
Ron Rakowski,
present.
Mike Hillman, Brad Weasley,
here.
Shakti, Dana Gutwein, Jerry Bean, Phil Cernanek,
present.
Jackie Millay, Wynn Shaw,
here.
Joan Peck,
here.
Ashley Stolzman,
here.
Connie Sullivan,
here.
Colleen Whitlow,
here.
Deborah Jerome, Sean Forey, Chris Larson, Kyle Mullica, Jordan Sowers, John Dyack,
here.
Sally Daigle,
here.
Rita Dozal,
here.
Adam Metkowski, Eric Montoya, Herb Atchison,
yes.
Joyce J, Adam Zarin,
here.
Deborah Perkins-Smith,
here.
Bill Van Meter,
here.
And we do have a quorum.
Yay, we have a quorum. Thank you, Connie. So I want to take a moment to mention new members and alternates. Commissioner Jan Pawlowski is the new alternate for Adams County. I don't think she's here, but we welcome her. Not to be confused with Trustee Joyce Palazuski, who's the new alternate for Meade. And is Joyce here? She's not here, but she's going to be awesome. Those Meade folks, they're passionate. And we do have here tonight Adam Zarin, who's the new non-voting member. He's a policy advisor representing the governor's office. So thank you for joining us. And do you know her name?
I don't know her
name. I'm told that we might have the proposed alternate for Federal Heights in the back. And I'm sorry I don't know your name, but we're happy.
I forgot it.
Carolyn Scharf.
Carolyn Sharp. Well, thank you for being here tonight. Welcome. And then last but not least, we have Tim Stewart from E470 joining us tonight to make sure that Mayor Rakowski gets the report correct. So thank you for joining us as well. So, yes. So I would consider a motion to approve the agenda. If
second.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We have a motion. So we'll begin with some strategic informational briefings. We are honored to have with us tonight Dr. John Nicoletti from Nicoletti Flater Associates and Sam Light, DRCOG counsel, to talk with us about organizational safety and liability. And Dr. Nicoletti has been here before to give this presentation, but it turns out Last time we heard it was 2009, which means only Mayor Rakowski was here to enjoy it. So we thought it was high time that we get a refresher on this and really be proactive on an issue that I think is increasingly in the news. Workplace safety is something that I think has been more on people's minds. I know we've had a handful of active shooter incidents in the Denver metro area over the last year. One struck near and dear to my heart, 1536 Wynkoop. The office building I worked in for 13 years had a murder-suicide incident that was just very traumatic. And I'm sure other jurisdictions are working on this issue. I know Boulder County is revamping staff training, looking at organizational facility layout and that kind of thing. So I'm sure your organizations are probably doing a similar thing. So we thought appropriate to get an update from the experts on this. And John's going to walk through the workplace safety, the reality of workplace safety and what to do. And then Sam's going to cover organizational issues, our current policies, and potential recommendations on ways we can improve them. So thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just kind of following up on what Madam Chair was talking about. Whenever we do these, we'll always get people saying, why are we doing this here? You know, is there something wrong that we need to be aware of? And the reality is you're just trying to be preventative. You're just trying to stay ahead of the curve. Workplace violence is, unfortunately, an ongoing problem that seems to be increasing. Madam Chair was mentioning the one down at Wynkoop, domestic violence. That's only one of four we've had in the past month and a half. Another one, active shooter scenario we had, was down south in Douglas County, where Douglas County Sheriff's deputy got shot and the individuals firing rounds into Parker Adventist Hospital. We had an individual walking through Rose Hospital allegedly with a rifle. And up in Boulder, we had, it's not called an active shooter, it's called an active herder. The individual was carrying a machete. So these things are happening on a regular basis. So what we're trying to do is not create paranoia, but actually talk about preparation. So we're each going to talk about 25 minutes. A lot of material to cover. There's some stuff I won't get to. It's on your handouts. I tend to present fairly interactively, so as I go through, please feel free to jump in at any point in time if you have questions. Okay, first question is, who do we deal with? Who do you deal with? If we were to look at the folks you interact with, whether it's here at DRCOG or in your own other jobs or life, we can take folks and put them on a continuum. The good end of the continuum are delightful folks. Do you have anybody like that? You know, okay, we've got a couple of them. Yeah, the delightful people are. They're individuals you enjoy being around. They have a good sense of humor. They're respectful, and we feel energized after talking to those folks. The majority of folks we deal with, you deal with, are task-oriented. In other words, they're here to do business, whatever business you're in. And so that's where the majority. Once in a while, you get what we call PIBs, which, if you're not familiar, stand for pain in the butts. I don't know, do you all have to deal with any of those? Don't point. PIBs are the ones that kind of make you roll your eyes like, oh, here we go again. Those are the normal ones. Those aren't the ones I'm going to focus on. If we drop below the line, we see a whole different group of folks. We see the disruptive, the volatile, and the violent. And that's what I'm going to kind of focus on in the time I have. Disruptive individuals. They won't kill you. They won't hurt you. What they do is they'll drive you crazy. They'll get you to overreact. That's kind of what they're trying to do. We're seeing a lot of that with kind of anti-government thought processes and attitudes in some of the rural areas. Those of you from that, you've probably seen that. You know, they'll follow around folks who work for the town, public works, road and bridge. They'll follow around with cell phone cameras. Individual go in for a coffee break, and they'll wait outside, and as soon as a person comes outside, they'll start their camera going, and they'll say, how can you do this on taxpayer dollars? And what they're trying to do is get that individual to say something dumb or push them or do something like that. Then all of a sudden they turn, I call them cry bullies. They'll push, 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 and then if you overreact, then they go report you to somebody. So that's the disruptive. Volatile is the type of individual that one minute they're fine, and the next minute they spin up. And you have no idea who you're dealing with at any point in time. Our body's pretty good about giving us indicators who we're dealing with. If you're dealing with a volatile person, when you're around that individual, you'll have a sensation of walking around on eggshells. That'll always tell you that you're dealing with a volatile person. Because when you have the sensation of walking around on eggshells, your brain is saying, be careful what you say, be careful what you do. We don't want to set this person off. And the third category are the violent folks. They're here to kill you. They're here to hurt you. So who should we be concerned with? That's the three we should be concerned with, the disruptive, the volatile, and the violent. You ever wonder who's going to come and kill you? You ever sit back and say, I wonder who's after me? There's going to be two categories of folks. One will be an insider, and the other will be an outsider. An insider is somebody on your radar. You knew about this person. So when they come, you shouldn't be surprised. Whereas an outsider is somebody that's not on your radar. So when they come, you're surprised, you're blindsided. An outsider locally, the Aurora Theater shooting, July 20th, 2012. Folks sitting in the movie, midnight showing, the individual in the front row with the red hair. They had no idea who he was, so that was an outsider. I was just this past week in Orlando working with the police department there on the Pulse shooting and helping kind of with the trauma recovery. So for the folks in the Pulse nightclub, that individual who came in, he was an outsider. They had no idea who that was. Now, one of the things we're seeing with outsiders, outsiders are scary. You need to realize that. But the majority of the folks who attack will be insiders, meaning they're on your radar. And even sometimes outsiders, they may not be on the radar of the people they attack, but they'll be on somebody else's radar. And I think the Aurora Theater shooting is a good example. You know, he wasn't on the radar of the folks in the movie theater, but he was on the radar at the University of Colorado Health Sciences Center where he was being seen. If we were to break down a little more specifically based on where people work and what they do, we can have other categories of attackers. I'm going to be focusing on avengers because that's kind of the one we always hear about. Avengers are folks who have a grudge against DRCOG or a school or a business. Predators are individuals that will sexually assault, sexually molest. Domestic, that's intimate partner violence. Entrepreneurs are folks who will come to steal things. And stalkers are individuals who engage in unwanted pursuits. There's a new category that's up there I haven't had a chance to put on there. I'm calling them creepy clowns. I don't know if any of you had to deal with those, but that's a new category. Okay, avengers. How does somebody become an avenger? What's the thought process that would cause an individual to all of a sudden decide to become an avenger? As we studied all the shootings going way back to the post office, we found definite characteristics of all these individuals. The first characteristic is a perceived injustice. And the key word there is perceived. It doesn't have to be real. A lot of times businesses and schools and agencies, they minimize that. The individual has an injustice, but it's more of a delusional injustice. And it's not real. Rather, it's a conspiracy theory or something like that. And the protectors, the folks that could do something, kind of minimize it. You cannot do that. If an individual has an injustice in their mind, you have to take it seriously. Now, if we don't stop them there, that's stage one. Stage two, the person starts to feel victimized. And what we look for there to see if the person's at stage two is you listen for one word in the sentence structure. And that word is because. Because you broke up with me, like what happened at Wine Coop. Because you kicked me out of school. Because you fired me. Because you won't allow me to have this project. Because. Stage three, externalization responsibility. You'll hear words like you, he, she, they, DRCOG, blaming somebody else. Now, the first three are concerning, but they're not dangerous. If you let them get past stage three, then we get concerned. Then the person develops a grudge. And once you develop a grudge, you have no choice but to be engaging in what we call obsession. Obsession is a looping in the brain where it consumes the individual. Now, obsession is like any other emotion. In other words, you could be sitting here and you could be having an emotion. You could be depressed, you could be happy, you could be stressed out, mad, whatever. And the person next to you will not know what your emotion is unless either you tell them or the emotion becomes so intense that you cannot control it. Then you start to get what we call seepage or leakage, where your anger starts coming on, or your sadness, or your depression. Same thing with obsession. For a while, it'll be, just be circulating in the person's head. But obsession is very intense, and soon it starts to come out. And the way it'll come out, like in your world, a couple categories. One we call psychodialing. That's where the person is calling all the time. The other, more importantly for you all, is psycho-emailing. Those of you that work for various cities, you probably get psycho-emailing, right? Now, how do we judge the degree of obsession from psycho-emailing? First of all, look at the number of emails. As the frequency increases, we know the obsession increases. How close together are they? The closer together, the more the obsession. The longer the emails, the more rambling in the emails. And the key variable is the number of people that get CC'd on an email. The more people that get CC'd, the greater the obsession. Then the other thing, and a lot of times folks miss this, is the time of day that the emails get sent. I'm working with one area where dozens of emails with a lot of folks CC'd, and the emails are coming at 2 in the morning. And the people who are responsible for assessing it totally miss it. They said, well, he's sending emails at 2 in the morning because he knows none of us are around. No, that's not why they're sending emails. Why do you think he's sending emails? Can't sleep. Then the intensity of the obsession becomes so great that the person can no longer contain themselves. Then they engage in an avenging action. That's what happened at the shooting at Wine Coop. We had to do the debrief for that. And DPD responded to that, right? Your officers over? Yeah. He was an avenger. He was obsessed. And what we'll hear in domestic violence, you'll literally hear people saying offshoots of this. You know, I can't live without you, and I'm not going to let you live without me. So that's the violent end. Now, there is a non-lethal end that, from my perspective, as far as preventing trauma, is a good thing. From some of yours, depending on your position, you may not like it, but it's always held up. And we actually have a saying for it. As long as they're suing you, they will not be shooting you. Until what? Until they perceive they're about to lose. Then they move over to the other track. So what should I look for, and when should I get concerned? The coding system we use to do our threat assessment that we train on is a very simple one. Human behavior can only fall into one of four categories: normal, boundary probing, attack-related, or attack. So at any point in time, you'll know who you're dancing with. You'll know where the person is. But in order to use this system, you have to start out with a good definition of normal. Now, when I ask audiences, what's your definition of normal? I get folks smiling and smirking, and everything. There's no definition of normal. Yes, there is. Those of you that have children, you have to have a definition of normal. Otherwise, how would you know when your child is having a problem? They deviated from normal. There's no one actual definition. It's based on the environment, the individual, and the event. So normal changes. Your normal changes. Probably shouldn't use this example with you. I'm used to presenting to cops, so I have no filters, but what do I mean by that? Would it be fair to say that your normal behavior in here would be different than your normal behavior at Mardi Gras? Yeah. If you were at Mardi Gras, you could be throwing beads and flashing yourself, and folks would be clapping. What would happen if you did that here? Yeah, that's a little tip. So it's relative to where it's at. Here's how powerful it is, the bombing, Boston Marathon bombing. How do you think they were able to catch one of the bombers so quickly? Deviation from normal. What do I mean? You're at the finish line of the Boston Marathon, enjoying yourself, and a bomb goes off. What do your instincts tell you to do? Run. So what is normal behavior when a bomb goes off? Running. What did the bomber do? He engaged in behavior we call desperately casual. Anytime you see that behavior, something's up. Now, it doesn't have to be for violence, but something is up. And actually, I imagine quite a few of you in here are experts at desperately casual. Those of you that have children, you will be experts at desperately casual behavior. What do I mean by that? Those of you that are parents, moms or dads, you ever busted your kid doing something they're not supposed to? Remember what they look like? That's desperately casual. Now, an individual cannot go from normal to an attack behavior. Can't do it. The next level they go to, which is where we always want agencies and groups to activate what we call countermeasures, is boundary probing. Everybody in here has parameters of what you'll tolerate, personally and professionally. So when somebody starts to boundary probe, they push the edge of your tolerance. And they do that to see what they can get away with. Now, people think this is all about mental illness. These aren't mental illness variables. These are normal things. What do I mean by that? Those of you who have children, have your children ever boundary probed on you? Okay, why are they doing that? Are they doing that because you're raising a little mini serial killer? And I know somebody's saying, I don't know, kid's only 8. They're doing that to see what they can get away with. So boundary probe, depending on the type of attacker, predators, individuals that are going to molest children have a different type of boundary probe than individuals who are going to steal things. And they're different than individuals who may be a workplace violent shooter. But you'll see the boundary probes. Every single case, you'll see the boundary probes. And it's easy to activate a countermeasure and stop the person. But what's happening, unfortunately, what we're seeing is we're creating our own brand of misery. You ever wonder where problems with a coworker or a kid or anybody starts? It starts right here. Whoops, let me find it. I guess it's not in here. It starts with allowing somebody to get away with a boundary probe. If you allow somebody to get away with a boundary probe, what are you doing about that behavior? You're allowing it to increase. And what do we know about getting away with boundary probes? Again, as you see, I jump back and forth to parenting. Those of you that are parents, say you let your kid get away with a goof-off behavior that they shouldn't. After your kid gets away with that behavior, do they typically come back to you and say, thanks, Mom or Dad, I'll never do that again? No, they increase. If we don't stop them, there they go to attack-related behaviors. Now, how did we arrive at this? We looked at the individuals who did these different attacks, and we looked at what are the variables that they engaged in. What are the variables you need to engage in an attack? And we found there are two of them. I call it the deadly duo. One is a desensitization, and the other is a dehumanization. Desensitization gives you the courage to engage in an attack. Dehumanization turns your targets from folks who have feelings and families to objects. How do you pick that up? What are the desensitization behaviors? Threatening. There is one predictor variable. You know, psychology, what I'm in, is a little different than physics and stuff. It's a soft science. But once in a while, we get a hard variable. So as we looked at every single attacker, what was the one thing they engaged in before they decided to attack? They made a threat. Threat making is a gateway to an attack behavior. Threats will come into three categories: direct, veiled, and conditional. Direct is kind of a slam dunk. I'm coming down there to kill you. I would hope if you get that, you're not going to say, oh, what'd that person mean? You know, were they serious? 100% of the attackers make threats, but only 15% of them make direct threats. So what does that mean the other 85% are doing? They're making either veiled or conditional. Veiled threats. There's two different ways we can pick up a veiled threat. One is with this brain, our central processing unit. The other is this brain down here, our detection unit. Let me give you examples of veiled threats using this brain, then we'll move down here. veiled threats would be, you know, there's two ways to do things. There's the DRCOG's way and there's mine. You have a heated argument with somebody, and as they're walking out of the room, they say, God bless you. I don't get mad, I get even. You don't know who you're dealing with. I'm surprised y'all haven't had a postal incident here. Sooner or later, you're going to push somebody too far. Saw you and your kids at the grocery store last night. Nice kids. Hopefully they stay healthy. Those are all veiled threats. They're all real. Now, if you're not experienced, how do you know that somebody gave you a veiled threat? It's real simple. If you ever have somebody saying something to you, and after they say it, you're wondering to yourself, I wonder what that person meant. You know they gave you a veiled threat. We use the same approach when we're doing suicide risk assessment. Say you have a teenage kid or somebody, and they say to you, you know, I'm not sure I'll be around for Christmas. As a mom or dad, you'd probably be saying, I wonder what they meant. It's a veiled threat. The third is a conditional threat. You listen for one or two words in the sentence structure, the word if or the word or. You know, if you deny me my project, I'll hunt you down. You better do this or. So that's a world of threats. Again, every attacker will make a threat. So we got to take threats seriously. Now, what does that mean? That doesn't mean you have to tase them, but at least you got to investigate them and you got to do something about it. The other part, if you look down at the bottom, disrespectful and derogatory language. That's how you dehumanize somebody. A lot of cities I work with will say, you know, to their employees, well, we're public servants. People pay for our jobs with their tax money, and you just got to put up with it. That worked 25 years ago. The world is different. Even if you're a public service agency, city, whatever, municipality, do not let folks be the recipient of disrespectful and derogatory language. That's part of the dehumanization. There's no reason to allow that to occur. If we don't stop them there, then they go to an attack. I do not differentiate people from property. In other words, hitting, pushing, shoving, those are attack behaviors. But so is breaking things, throwing things, kicking things. Those are also attack behaviors. So it gives you a simple way to assess where somebody's at. And I'm just about out of time, so I'm going to jump ahead. Focus on the what instead of the who. People get in trouble when they focus on a who. A who are those categories. And that'll cause you to either underreact or overreact. An example of overreacting we're seeing now is if you read about any of these shootings, somewhere in the article, they will say the individual was mentally ill. You ever read that? They will say the individual was paranoid, schizophrenic. Or Asperger's, that's a big one now. Everybody who attacks is Asperger's. So we did an assessment of all the different diagnoses that we hear for the different shooters. And we tried to see, was there a characteristic diagnosis that correlated with it? And the answer is no. Mental illness is not a predictor variable. Plus the other thing, this is how urban legends get started. We tried to find out, okay, this individual was diagnosed as psychotic or paranoid schizophrenic. So I'm thinking, you know, being a psychologist, well, it must have been diagnosed by a psychologist or psychiatrist. But as we did the investigation, you know who did the diagnosis? The next door neighbor. Oh, that person seems like they have Asperger's. Then the media picks it up. This individual has Asperger's, and everybody else believes it. It was based on a goofy neighbor who had no idea what they're talking about. So we don't focus on who's, we focus on the behavior. Cartoon after Columbine. The key word in the sentence structure is a good predictor of future violence, and that's the word just. All attackers will broadcast before they attack you. So in that scenario, well, it's probably just some harmless teenage phase he's going through. Words will activate different parts of the brain if you buy into it. So the word just will actually cause you to minimize the threat. You ever hear that word just? Just joking, just frustrated, just having a bad day. If you buy into that, then you're going to turn your back on it. So the training thing we get at is when you hear the word just to describe somebody's behavior, instead of feeling calm, your antenna should go up. Last thing, what do you do with concerning behaviors? This is a simple concept. When I go in for trauma to help recover, this has been violated. Simple concept. If the individual broadcasts it, you all need to believe it. And they try and find, how come nobody believes it in this particular agency? The number one reason is tea leaf reading. Tea leaf reading is where every agency has a tea leaf reader. And they're actually kind of dangerous. Tea leaf readers are, you go to somebody and you're concerned, and that person says, oh, don't worry about them. They're just blowing off steam. So current best practices is if you have a concerning behavior, you need to be doing something about it. You need to be doing what we call countermeasures or trees. So we're always interrupting it. What are the trees? They fall into three categories. Everything you could do is a countermeasure falls into three categories. Questioning, confronting, consequences. Questioning, if somebody says to you there's two ways to do things, there's Dr. Cog's and there's mine, a questioning tree would be, what do you mean by that? If somebody says to you, nice kids, hopefully they stay healthy, questioning would be, what do you mean by that? Now, you don't have to go in order. People sometimes think you got to go in order. No. Somebody's choking you, do you really want to start with the category one tree? Hey, what's up with that, man? How come you're choking me? No. You can go to confronting, knock it off, stop. Or consequence, call the police, hang up, do whatever you need to do. So I've gone over my time. What I wanted to get across is, you know, we cannot necessarily predict violence, not to that level, but we certainly can prevent violence. And one of the problems in preventing violence that we see is you take appropriate action and there'll be somebody saying, oh, you all overreacted. That person would have never done that. You don't know that. So you got to feel comfortable with the sensation of overreacting when you do the right thing. Thank you all. And Sam's going to get up here now.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to cover a little bit of the legal side of this, the objectives of my slides, and I'll stay within my time limit, or else.
Are you just joking?
But I don't question. Don't question me. For those of you I haven't had the pleasure of presenting to before, I'm Sam Light. I'm general counsel for DRCOG. I do want to thank the board for allowing me to be absent last month. I know we were scheduled to go last month, but I appreciate your indulgence in allowing us to push this over a month because of a family matter that I had. My objectives are to go over some of the theories of legal liability so that you as the leaders of the organization have some familiar with the concepts of legal liability in this area and the theories of liability that can be used to create a legal situation for either DRCOG as an entity or yourselves as elected or appointed officials and your employees as well. And then a couple of slides on what we do looking forward, sort of setting the table for some things we can do as an organization to help stay proactive in this area. And I've got some suggestions for some things we might, with your blessing, work on as staff as we move forward. So first, talking about liability considerations, we need to understand that workplace violence issues can expose DRCOG as an employer to legal liability under a number of theories. And those include things like negligence, respondeat superior, which I'll define in a moment. There's potential liability under workers' compensation law, premises liability, and a number of other theories. We need to recognize that the reach of exposure comes from a various number of sources. We can face exposure from an alleged victim of an incident that occurs on your premises, perhaps a claim from third parties who are injured on your premises or during some incident that occurs here. And you can, in the context of investigating and dealing with a threat, you could run a risk of liability vis-a-vis the alleged perpetrator who feels like their privacy rights have been violated or that you're defaming them by pursuing some intervention activity or some of the steps that John mentioned. Someone may get their back up and think that they've been wrong somehow and are going to pursue legal action. But let's dig in these a little bit. So negligence, as we know, that's the idea that you have a duty to keep people safe, and in the workplace violence arena, you may face liability for negligence resulting from a failure to provide a safe workplace for the employees, or failing to warn employees about latent dangers, or failing to promulgate and enforce rules governing employees. This realm is where you've breached some duty to an injured party, and they pursue damages. Now, the interesting thing in Colorado is we have the Colorado Governmental Immunity Act, right? And in order to sue the organization for negligence, you failed to live up to some duty that you have to get around the governmental immunity statute. You have to show that immunity has been waived and that you therefore can pursue a claim on this theory. Let's say it's you have a duty, say someone says, Dr. Cog, you have a duty to maintain a safe work environment. Well, the Colorado Governmental Immunity Act might suggest that's not a claim you can bring under the statute. Now, interestingly, there's a foot in the door on this issue already. All the more reason to stay proactive. Last year in 2015, the legislature adopted Senate Bill 15-2013 that did create for school districts a duty recognizable under tort law to protect students, faculty, and visitors from harm on a school campus. So we now have, under our immunity statute, a recognized theory of liability for negligence. So when I say the foot in the door there, that becomes the question of next legislative session, one down the road, will there be a conversation that these same principles ought to extend to all public entities that undertake public activities? So that's the negligence theory of liability. Respondeat superior is just a fancy way of saying the employer is responsible for things that the employee does. It's a vehicle to hold an employer responsible for the acts of its employees. An employee can include a volunteer, an elected or appointed board member, or a committee member. So any of our individuals that are within our tent and serve Dr. Cog as paid or unpaid staffers or officials or agents or volunteers can all fit under this theory of liability, which is the concept that generally the employer somehow should be responsible for the violent act of an employee. Now, the main way of defending against this is obviously the argument that, well, we can't be responsible because it was the intervening misconduct of the employee, and therefore we can't be held responsible. And that's generally the case, particularly if it's criminal activity. The employer cannot be held liable for that. But there are some potential exceptions. And the one that is sort of creeping into the jurisprudence is this recognized concept that where the employer consents to or ratifies or even tolerates without acting the conduct or the misconduct of its agent, then it can be held responsible under this theory of liability. Okay. The Colorado Workers' Compensation Act, this is primarily the source of liability for personal injuries for your employees. This is the vehicle that they may have to recover for their injuries if there's a workplace violence incident occurring in your offices or in your meeting room or something like that. It's the, of course, the vehicle for employees to receive compensation benefits for injuries that arise out of or in the course of their employment. Well, looking at that, how does an incident of workplace violence arise out of or in the course of employment? Well, if we have someone at the front desk greeting people and they are there during working hours and doing what they're doing and a coworker hits them, it may well be that we as an employer will say, well, that injury happened during the course and scope of employment. For police officers, the injuries they suffer quite often it's part of the job, unfortunately, is that they may be the victim of some act that requires they go under the workers' compensation statute. In many situations, it might be that the workers' compensation statutes are the exclusive remedy, right? The grand bargain under workers' compensation is that if you are injured on the job, then you must submit your claim to workers' compensation, and that gives you wage replacement, takes care of your medical bills. But the other half of that grand bargain is for workers' compensation, you give up your right to pursue any other type of claim against the entity. So, as respects an incident involving an employee during working hours on the job where the injury occurred out of their job duties during the scope of their employment, it may be that as an employer, we're going to say that your only recourse is the Workers' Compensation Act, but you need to be aware that that's slowly being chipped away at. Of course, Colorado Workers' Comp statutes do not prevent someone from bringing a federal law claim for injuries if they want to do that, or if they can find some other type of duty. Just as an example, mentioning that statute regarding the schools, the injured faculty member now can argue not only are they entitled to workers' comp, but they now have this right of action under the Colorado Governmental Immunity Act because you as the school have a duty to protect me from harm by third parties. So that's the workers' compensation statute. Premises liability is probably one that's front and center for us. This meeting room right now at this time is our premises as Dr. Cog. We're in control of the premises. So we're the landowner for purposes of premises liability. And as we're required to do and as we want to do, we are open and our meetings are open and we invite guests in, but we have an obligation under the law to protect our guests from harms that we know exist or we should know exist. And this is a theory of liability that is used in violent incidents. High-profile cases, the Aurora Theater shooting cases, some of the recent decisions that you've seen in the newspaper, most recently I think Judge Jackson issued a ruling from the victim's family talking about the movie theater's responsibility as a landowner to protect the moviegoers from harm. And that's a premises liability theory. Judge Jackson a month or two ago entered a ruling that said, look, that theory exists. We know it's out there. But in this particular case, the intervening criminal activity of the perpetrator is the overriding cause. So there was not a sufficiently recognized duty under law to say that the movie theater should be responsible under the premises liability statute. The whole causation question was answered by the criminal conduct of the shooter. But premises liability statutes are in play and are an important thing to remember from an organizational standpoint to be vigilant and make sure that we attend to how we arrange our premises, entrance, egress, security personnel, maybe alarms, how do we lay out the room, all those things that help protect against threats. Okay. Let me switch gears a little bit to talk about prevention, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about our current policies on response. One of the things as an organization, of course, is to make sure that we have in place an effective program to help prevent workplace violence before it occurs, because that's where we want to be. It's better to prevent than to react. You know, the OSHA statutes don't apply to us because there's an exemption for governmental entities and their political subdivisions, but it's helpful to sort of look at what they view as to be the effective elements of a good workplace violence prevention policy. And of course, that starts with a management or a leadership commitment and employee involvement in detecting and preventing incidents of workplace violence. The management commitment runs up and down all levels. And it starts with the governing body and runs all the way down to individual employees to all commit to the principles of zero tolerance for behavior that may violate a workplace violence policy, and to set expectations and all commit to agreed upon norms of conduct for each other, for our employees, for our vendors, for ourselves. So that's an important cornerstone of a good workplace violence prevention policy. Work site analysis of security, the kind of things that John and his firm do to analyze systems that we have in place to help us make sure that the facilities we use and premises that we control do have appropriate protections. Hazard prevention and control, safety and health training for employees and management, and elected and appointed officials who lead the organization. It's one of the reasons we have these kind of trainings, is to help keep these issues in the forefront. Good record keeping and workplace evaluation for events that do occur. Allow sufficient resources to prevent violence and unsafe situations from you, from a leadership position. That, of course, perhaps you may only see that as a budget line item, but make sure that you're looking at it and saying, do we have the resources available? Do we have the systems that we need? Do we need more resources in order to have an effective workplace violence prevention program? Develop systems of accountability, and that runs all the way up and down, and that's for everyone, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that in my going forward slides in a moment. And of course, you hear this last bullet a lot, and it's in all the policies that you see, but the words are only as good as the commitment. As John mentioned, if you see a trigger and you let it go, and you say, oh, it's just that, are we really committing to a zero tolerance policy? So it's a matter of keeping our antenna up and dealing with zero tolerance in a way that shows that we mean and do commit to that principle. Okay. Let me talk a little bit about what Dr. Cog currently has in place for its workplace threats and violence policy. It's primarily a policy that was adopted through the Executive Director's Office as an administrative policy in June of 2012. Updated in March of 2016. It is, as the last bullet just mentioned, a zero-tolerance policy for any forms of workplace violence. We, under that policy, have a system in place where if there is a report of a violation of the workplace safety standards, then there is a threat and violence assessment team that currently consists of the executive director, the administrative officer, and legal counsel as warranted, and that group together sometimes with additional outside resources, consulting with security personnel or with John or with others that were responsible for receiving, investigating, tracking, and resolving reports of circumstances that raise concerns for employee safety. And there's also an ongoing review of developing and implementing prevention strategies. The idea of workplace violence, I know that John mentioned at the outset the question about this balance between preventing workplace violence and honoring First Amendment rights and so on, but this is a fairly standard common definition of what workplace violence is. I thought it'd be helpful to put that out there just so we see how the words operate when we put a policy in place. Our policy defines workplace violence as conduct in the workplace that is meant to harm, cause fear in, intimidate, or intimidate another, which includes but is not limited to physical threats against persons or property, direct or veiled threats, profanity, vicious or abusive statements, written threats, the use of profanity, vicious cartoons, notes, emails, frequent emailing, serial emailing, or other written or symbolic conduct, stalking, one of the categories that John mentioned, and with certain exceptions, weapons possession. So we have that in place now. I do emphasize that was put in place as an administrative policy. On a going forward basis, one of the items I wanted to put before the board was the suggestion that the board endorse the idea that the policy be updated to make sure that it applies across all facets of the organization, including the board, committees of the board, clearly say to our vendors and our partners that it applies to their agents and employees when they're working with Dr. Cog, and those are some updates that we might bring forward with you to look at. We also want to suggest that the board think about having a board and committee level policy statement to promote the commitment to safety and prevent violence or threatening behavior. In looking at options, that could run the gamut from bringing back to you some change in your articles of association to make it clear that the board itself has got something there that commits to these principles, as well as maybe a board resolution. The board also ought to look at the question of whether it desires to, I think in an ad hoc way, you set expectations for how you run your meetings and what you expect of each other as far as mutual respect and how we run the meeting and how we deal with disruptions, but you might think about whether it's prudent for the board to adopt some more formal policy statement of how it deals with norms of conduct for its own members, for its own committees, and also how it deals with disruption at meetings. I know that John mentioned incident in Boulder. When you're in a public meeting setting, you want to have in advance a procedure in place for dealing with disruptive citizens who arrive at your meeting so that it's not ad hoc. And that you have a system in place that's defensible and puts everyone in a safe place quickly without getting into a situation where you may unduly pick up some liability claim from the people involved, right? Also, looking at implementing preventive policies, that's another issue for the board. Looking at, do we have sufficient preventive policies in place? Do we have adequate budgeting for security plans and resources for training that we need? Those are things to look at on an ongoing basis. In talking briefly with the executive committee, we were of the mind that if there was no objection from the board, we do think that a board level commitment to these points starts with some action or discussion by the board. Perhaps the performance and engagement committee develops something for the board then to look at and brings that back for discussion. At the end of the day, I think it's perhaps some sort of document that emphasizes the board's commitment to these principles, and then from there the board would have to decide what further steps it would like to take to formalize its expectations on how the board deals with these kinds of issues for itself, its boards, its committees, and everyone within the organization. So with that, I'm going to stop and take any questions that you have for me, if you have questions for John as well. I do appreciate your time very much.
Okay. Hey, thank you very much to both of you. We do have a few minutes for questions. I think Laura and then Bob, or Director Christman, excuse me, then Director Roth.
Mike.
I've had to deal with this issue more than once. Let's just use a hypothetical. Zero tolerance policy, person is released based on non-criminal behavior. So we're talking about language, threatening behavior, but not criminal behavior. CIRSA advised us, or whomever, in a theory, that if this person who then resigns, goes to go work for, apply to David, and David calls me and says, so-and-so has applied, we're permitted to say this was the dates of their employment. We're not permitted to say, yeah, but you better get a bulletproof vest. So what happens is are these people, I mean, I may have solved it for my community, but this person just bounces to another community. Is that what we have to do? We cannot say anything?
I'm going to make a comment about sort of the liability risk in that area, and then John, if you want to add. So a lot of municipalities, counties will have a policy that says when you leave employment, we give out your name, rank, last position held, and the date you worked, and that was it, right? What you're concerned about is whether you have actual knowledge that the person did something that ought to be concerning to their future employer, right? So there are, first of all, the truth is always okay, right? If you can prove it, right? Now, telling someone you need to get bulletproof vests is not a fact, right? So that's going to get you into trouble, right? So a lot of municipalities will just say, let's just stick to our policy and only give out the dates and times. There are a few cases out there that do say that failing to disclose information that you actually know about, that is creating a risk, a tangible risk in the future is tantamount to making a material omission of fact. Okay, for example, I think this was a case involving, I think it was out of the southeast, where a principal settled out with the existing school district. It involved molestation of a student, right? And as part of the settlement, they agreed to give a neutral or okay reference to future employers. Well, they gave this reference to an employer, and we know what happens next, right? So then the victims sue the first employer and say, you knew. And in that particular case, they did. They did face some liability because the court said, you had knowledge of this. It was maybe if you gave no reference at all, it wouldn't be a liability risk, but you basically took an affirmative duty when you gave a reference that was glowing. You ended up omitting material information. So that's the kind of circumstance that causes people to land on the idea of saying, say nothing, because you won't take on more duty, you won't assume more risk. But anymore, when I counsel municipalities and we have that situation, we try to, if we're trying to move on past that employee and get them out of the workplace environment, we try to say to them, nothing is being held in confidence. So if that employee wants to get a future job, quite often the future employer will say, you've got to give us a release for all of your employment records, including any investigations that were undertaken while you were at your old job, and then we'll just produce the document, and the document will speak for itself. But we won't typically offer up new opinions or things that we can't prove as a matter of fact.
Actually, that's more legal. I think you covered it.
Okay. Director Roth, and then Director Dozo.
I just wanted to mention that I do support this going to the committee. And this may go without being said, but the review and budget for security plans and resources and training, I think that we need to have something discussed at the committee level and recommended to the board that this kind of training happens on a set period so that we don't have a seven-year period where Mayor Rakowski is the only one that's ever heard this. But I think that, you know, especially with the turnover on this board, I think it would be important that maybe every 24 months or something like that, we have a review of this.
Thanks. Director Dozell?
I just asked a question about in one of my former lives in a large corporation, the one thing we could do is answer the question, either yes or no, is the former employee eligible for reemployment with your company? And if you said no, then that pretty much ended the conversation with the one that was looking, and that was what we couldn't communicate information about it, but we could answer the question, would you reemploy this person?
Good point. Did Director Shenanik?
Yes, Sam, this might be more in your area because you mentioned it. When you mention applies across all facets of the organization and you include vendors and partners in that, recognizing that the Colorado Department of Transportation and RTD are partners, as well as we have grantees as a grantor organization that include municipalities and counties across the service area. How far does that go, and what are we looking for from vendors and partners in that regard?
Well, I think, and it's in our current policy statement, that we ask employees that if they feel like they've been the victim of workplace violence, they ought to report that so it can be reviewed and a determination made of what steps to take. And the policy statement says report that incident irrespective of where it comes from, whether it's from a fellow employee or a spouse or a client or a vendor or anyone else who's on our premises or that we're interacting with as part of our jobs. So I think the idea is to set up that expectation. I think we have to understand we don't have direct sort of remedies, right, against you know, a vendor's employee, other than perhaps return to that vendor and tell them that this incident occurred. But we do want to set up in our policy the expectation and hope that whether it's an employee or an elected or appointed official, that if they are the target of workplace violence from those outside representatives who come to our place of business, that we ought to look at it and see what the appropriate step is to deal with it. I fully understand that you can't go to that vendor and say, fire that person necessarily, right? But you do want to set up an expectation that people who come onto our premises are expected to abide by the norms of conduct that we establish for ourselves here at DRCOG. So to go back to the other question, I do appreciate that. I think that's a very pragmatic solution of saying, are they eligible for rehire? I always get a little nervous because I understand in the HR world that's code for something, right? And so the question becomes, in a legal proceeding, the question becomes, how do you answer the next questions that are being asked in the deposition? Well, what does that mean, to borrow a phrase, right? What did you mean by that when you said they're not eligible for hire? Why are they not eligible for rehire? But I do agree, as an initial point of departure, it does create very little liability risk and is a pretty pragmatic solution that I see people using a lot. But there's code behind that, right?
Yeah, there's code, but it's better than saying, we're neutral, go ahead and hire them if you want, and they've done something really egregious.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely, I agree.
Any other final questions or comments? Director Shenanik.
So that it's equal opportunity on this. This one's for John. John, you know, about 150 yards from here, there's an organization that does display called Cell, and they talk about terror threats. And where do you see that overlap and the vigilance and see something, say something that might occur in your levels of understanding?
There is some overlap and there's some distinct differences too. An example of where both of them merged together and it created a lot of controversy was the Fort Hood shooting, the very first Fort Hood shooting with an individual by the name of Major Hassan. So when that happened, they originally said it was workplace violence, so the military folks didn't get an opportunity to get benefits. It was actually both. If you went in his office, you could see a lot of terrorist stuff, but he did a unique thing that a lot of terrorists don't do. He broadcast ahead of time. Typically, terrorists will not broadcast ahead of time, whereas Avengers will broadcast ahead of time. So that's kind of the difference. Also, there's a difference when they move to the active shooter scenario. This is kind of bizarre, but it's the only way to get it across. So with an active shooter scenario, they'll shoot, and if a person's horizontal, they'll move on. Working with the Orlando folks, the terrorist would shoot and people would fall down, and instead of moving on, he'd go up and he'd kick them to see if they're alive, and if they moved, he'd shoot them again. So there's a difference in the detection phase, and there's a difference in the survival phase. So there's some overlaps, but you got to have your unique kind of profiles for each of them. I don't know if that answered your question or not.
Sersha? Sorry. Were you done?
That's okay. Thank you.
All right. Director Sherris Grace.
So in the training, what's the scope of that training? What's the length of it? And when we look at it in the committee, we could maybe dive into that a little bit more, but I'm curious. It's more than 20 or 30 minutes just talking from slides, yes?
Yes. So, and I can speak from the psychological, and then Sam can talk about the legal. The training varies according to the population. So within any organization, there are three levels of responsibility. There are detectors and disruptors, and there are disruptors. So like within a school or a business, the frontline employees are the detectors. They just need to know what to look for, how to stay safe, and who to report it. That training is generally about 2 hours. Then the managers and supervisors, the leadership, they have dual responsibility. They're detectors and disruptors. So in other words, if they see something, they need to take action. So that training is about 4 hours. Then for like what are called threat assessment teams, they're pure disruptors, and that training is about 8 hours. I mean, you can obviously cut them back, but that's purely from the psychological. And I don't know how much Sam has in terms of his.
Just with respect to the addition of some legal training on that issue, it's mostly focused on the disruptors, to use John's phrase, and that's how to it overlaps with HR training in terms of how to carry out investigation and document issues and deal with disciplinary issues in a way that's defensible. And those are sessions that you do an hour or 2 hours at a time to help primarily work on the HR aspects of getting it right and making sure that you're honoring the various legal rules that are in play whenever you do an investigation or have to carry out discipline. So.
A follow-up?
Yeah. Go ahead.
So the training would be different for employees that are housed within DRCOG as opposed to the Board of Directors. Yes?
Yeah, and we actually arranged for the training of employees, frontline receptionists, and supervisors here at DRCOG. So they've all been trained.
That seemed obvious, but I just wanted to hear you say it.
So maybe we could wrap up. Do you have a question? Go ahead. Don't be shy. Wait.
I'm also trying to be mindful of the chair trying to move business. Let me first thank our counsel and consultant for a very meaningful discussion about the delicate issue of workforce safety and workspace safety. I agree with Director Roth that this should be pushed to committee and that we should have recurrency training around this issue for both board members and staff. I also wanted to offer up a couple of thoughts. The City and County of Denver has now implemented mandatory run, hide, fight training for all 11,000 city employees. Every member of the mayoral appointee staff, et cetera, has gone through that training, and so I support it. I think it's a very high utility training for all employees when it comes to workforce safety. I also question what our formal social media use policy is at DRCOG and how that connects with bullying policies around social media use, since they are private assets for employees here. And so that's another thing that I would suggest that the committee take up. But again, I just want to applaud our counsel and consultant for leading us to this exercise and for the officers who have taken this up.
Thank you for that. Well, I was going to a similar wrap-up place, which is I think PNE is already queued up to deal with this issue. We heard some specific recommendations from council. Does anybody have any issue with having PNE take a look closely at those recommendations, including the recommendations around training, and bringing that back to the board? And I see the chair would like to say something on that.
Just in kind of wrap up, we had initially planned to talk about this last month, but as Sam had a family emergency, we didn't have that briefing. We laid it off a month. P&E has already been queued up that this is coming. It was going to be something we were starting to work on, but we had said not until we get the briefing for the full board. Tonight, that fulfilled that piece of it. So this will become an agenda item for P&E to start working on among the three other items that we have on our agenda right now.
So assuming there is no objection to that, we'll move forward with this issue in that way. And thank you all again for the great presentation and good conversation it fostered. All righty, so this brings us to the report of the chair. And I don't have too much to report other than what RTC did yesterday, which was to unanimously approve the reallocation of the FY 2016-17 station area management plan funds that had been previously allocated. We're going to deal with that issue in a moment. And then one of the roles that the board chair plays is to annually review TAC appointments, specifically the seven special interest members to TAC, and make recommendations on vacancies. And the RTC looked at my recommendations and approved them. There's seven special interest members on TAC, and those are environment, freight, transportation demand management / non-motorized, aviation, business economic development, non-RTD transit, and senior interests. And there were only two changes. The non-RTD transit member was held by Lena Kotke from VIA. She's retired. So the recommendation was to move up Hank Broxma from Senior Resource Center, who is currently the alternate, to move into the member position. And then for the TDM / non-motorized member, the tradition is to rotate that every 2 years between a TDM representative and a non-motorized representative. So the recommendation was basically to switch the two the member to the alternate member. So that would have Ted Hyde of Bicycle Colorado being the member and Aileen McCallum of Downtown Denver Partnership being the alternate. So RTC did approve those changes, and they go into effect immediately. Did I get that right?
Yes, you did.
All right. So I think that was all for me. I'm going to see if Director Atchison had anything else to add from P&E.
Just a couple of, so that the entire board knows some of the things that we have on our plate right now. First one we've started to tackle, and a lot of this is being done with Jerry and the board members, is the performance appraisal tool that we've been using in the past. We've started to working through some of that. There's some updates that will be coming out from Jerry. I've got a document I'm reviewing for him right now just to see if I can spot anything that Jerry likes to make mistakes, just to see if I can find them. So it's a hunt and peck type of thing. The onboarding process, a lot of comments have already come in from some of the members about how we need to engage that, bring that up, and really start looking for the mentorship for onboarding of new people and helping the training. The other one we're playing with is, because this came up out of the retreat, how do we find a viable date that can get us the most participation in the retreat and continue to make the retreat as successful as it was this past year? And last but certainly not least is the one we just had our briefing on, the security policy for the board. Those are the things that we have on our plate that we're working through right now.
Thank you, Director Atchison. And I'll turn to Director Pfeiffer to tell us about Budget Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We tonight approved the draft budget for 2017, so that will be coming to the board next month for approval. We kind of went through a lot of topics around merit increases in the budget itself and churn and some other things, so I think our committee did a good job combing through the budget, and we're ready to bring it to the full board next month.
Great, thanks for that. And then our acting director, Doug Rex.
Great, thank you, Madam Chair, and I just have a couple things myself. I'd like to draw your attention to two single pieces of paper that are at your place. The first I'll speak to is the one that has the USDOT logo in the top left-hand corner. Every 4 years, FHWA and FTA are required by federal law to jointly conduct a review of the Metropolitan Transportation Planning process. Just so you all know, it's not necessarily a review of DRCOG, it's a review of the entire transportation planning process we have, of our partners, including RTD and CDOT, and they're required to do that every 4 years. And the letter that FTA and FHWA sent yesterday basically recertifies us for the next 4 years. Yay. This is great. So they sent this letter ahead of the finalizing their report. We hope to get that in the coming days, weeks, whenever that might be. So they will have recommendations for ways to improve our process, which we always welcome. And as part of that as well, they recognize various strengths and practices within the organization and our transportation planning process. So I wanted to alert you to that. That's good news for sure. The second thing, piece of paper I would like to talk to is a letter addressed to you all from the Metro Mayor's Caucus. It's a letter expressing the Metro Mayor's Caucus's appreciation for the board's support of the Mobility Choice Blueprint Initiative. You'll recall that as originally conceived, that the funding for that study was going to be split between ourselves, CDOT and RTD. Not the Downtown Partnership. Yeah. And for the study, it was just going to be those three public agencies. The actual nonprofit itself was going to be funded by the chamber and private sector folks. And as you recall, last month we had a discussion about the finance, RTD's finance committee decided not to fund the RTD share at that time, and we talked about basically is there a path forward for this, and the Mobility Choice Board as well as staff from the three public agencies have been in discussions to determine if that's the case. You know, we as staff believe this is an important endeavor. We know that the Denver Metro Chamber believes that this is a that this is an initiative that we should continue to pursue. And we have had discussions, you know, about, you know, how we can backfill that $500,000 or something of, you know, something enough to get to a point where we feel is appropriate for a study of this nature. I'd like to tell you that we have all the I have all the answers here today, which I do not. I would ask that, you know, for your patience as we go through this process, and you know, hopefully this time next month we will have something. I'll be able to report back to you all in a more definitive type fashion that that, you know, we will have a direction or we won't. And so it, I guess I plead to you all, just give us a little bit more time to be able to figure this all out. The other part of the Metro Mayor's Caucus letter is actually in the last sentence of the letter, and I'll just read it. You see, we applaud your investment in Mobility Choice Blueprint and hope you will stand with Metro Mayor's Caucus in encouraging the RTD board to reconsider their investment in this planning process. I didn't know if that's something we want to take a formal position on, but I just throw that out there for your consideration. I have one more thing probably before we address that. And seeing we're on that topic, I would like to recognize three DRCOG communities that were selected to participate in the National Smart Cities Collaborative. It was in, I know it was in the paper here yesterday, the cities of Centennial, Denver, and Lone Tree were selected. There were three of 16 cities that were selected. There was a group of nearly 60 communities that that wanted to participate in that collaborative. It's being sponsored by Transportation for America and Sidewalk Labs, and according to the T4A press release, over the coming years, the cities will tackle and challenge related technology in implementing smart city policies and projects. So congratulations to them, and I'm sure we would appreciate briefings as you go forth with that endeavor, because it does dovetail very well with our Mobility Choice Initiative. And with that, Madam Chair, I'm done.
So I wanted to, before we leave the Mobility Choice Blueprint item, the Metro Mayor's Caucus letter makes it sound like they're formally going to the RTD board. Is this something they're doing in November, or do we know that there's going to be a vote to reconsider? Or what specifically are they asking us to join them in doing? Do we know?
No, we do not. Nothing other than the letter. I'm looking at Bill, and Bill has no record.
First I've seen or heard of this letter.
Yeah. We got it this afternoon.
Director Graves.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was actually at the Metro Mayor's Caucus meeting when this letter was discussed. I don't think they formalized the actual action with the RTD board on behalf of the Metro Mayor's Caucus, but they wanted to first express to a fellow supporting organization that they intend to do so. And I think part of the discussion was the idea that DRCOG might articulate in some formal way as well their position on this issue to the RTD Board of Directors. I'm speaking without the chair being present, but that's my recollection of the meeting.
Well, in the past, when Mobility Choice Blueprint has come to us, we have unanimously approved the concept, and we conditionally approved our participation contingent on the active involvement and approval of RTD and CDOT. It would seem to me, and I'm saying this out loud so that you all can say whether or not that seems right, that it would be probably something that we would want RTD to consider, since our participation is contingent, at least the way we set it up, on their participation, to ask them to take a look at that again, given our enthusiasm for the project. Director Atchison.
I don't disagree, and I think one of the things that's going on right now is there's a lot of work going on because of the action of the Finance Committee, that RTD is talking among themselves. I think they're talking to Mobility Choice. There's a lot of information flowing around, and before we start a bunch of rumors or unsubstantiated comments, my only understanding is the RTD board members are working among themselves to come up with a review. And what they do with it, I don't think they're ready to sell anybody at this point. But I think there's still a lot of consternation over possibly just the timing of when that was brought to them. because they got it the same night. They got a big cut and a bunch of other stuff, and I think they caught a few people flat-footed, and there is talk going among the board directors.
Director Dozell?
Just to be clear, though, I think our last action as a board here was, as you said, to all three would participate, or otherwise we would not participate. So that's the last action that we've had at the board. We have not directed anybody to go off and find the money someplace else or fill in the gaps. So I just want to be clear where we're at as the DRCOG board.
What she said.
Is that correct?
Yeah, that is exactly correct. And if there is a path forward that's different than what was agreed to originally, there would be, it would require another action if we were to go that route.
So let me ask staff, do you need any direction from the board tonight other than the past direction, which is the action that Director Dozell had?
I don't believe discussed. So, unless you guys okay. feel strongly to do
it.
Yeah, correct.
Director Graves.
Point of clarification, Madam Chair. So just to be clear, given the last recorded action, is it dying on the vine now here with the Board of Directors, or we're in a holding posture until we have more information from RTD?
The latter.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, so we will be patient. We'll be actively patient, awaiting further updates. I would just want to add one more announcement to my report, which is the new nominating committee will be seated in November. So if you are interested in volunteering to serve on the nominating committee, you should indicate your interest to Connie. And there will also be an email coming out from Connie directing you to indicate an interest if you would like to be considered to serve as a board officer on the executive committee. So search your souls on your desired level of engagement with DRCOG. There's two great opportunities to serve, and make sure you speak with or email, communicate with Connie in some way about that. And with that, I want to open up our public comment period if there's anybody in the audience that would like to approach us to speak to us for up to 3 minutes on a matter that is not previously been before us. We have a taker. All right.
Madam Chair, this has been before you previously, but I
butchered that. You're
all right. Very good. I'm here with Jim Gunning, Don Hunt. I'm the acting director of Mobility Choice, and I think you had an excellent discussion of where we are, so I don't know how much we can add, but we just want to let you know that this is important. It's important to the Denver Chamber to continue on, but we also have to have willing partners. So that's what we're working on. Just to remind you, this is something that will hopefully bring greater private sector leadership into the future of Denver transportation. Hopefully it will provide ways for strategic alignment of the three major transportation agencies. And I think what is the most compelling part of this is the speed with which technology will be changing mobility and transportation. We want to be in front of that, just like Denver and Lone Tree and Centennial, right? And so we want the whole region to be part of that. So that's what Mobility Choice is about. Just to let you know what has happened over the last month, we had the RFP all ready to go out to the consulting community. We have Jim Gunning ready to take over as the managing director of the effort, the project manager for the project, and I will take more of an advisory role when we get going. We've had great interest and support. We continue to talk to a lot of the stakeholders around the region, including the Transportation Management Association and other public and private stakeholders. On November 1st, just to put a little pitch in for the CDOT Summit on November 1st, the Mobility Choice Technology Committee has been combined with the CDOT Innovisors Council. It's a way to get leadership and technological expertise into what's going on transportation and mobility, and for CDOT and Mobility Choice, and we hope Dr. Cog and we hope RTD to have access to what is going to be a great group of people that really can help us reach into the private sector and find out some of the knowledge that maybe we need to have. It's changing so rapidly. And then I think I've hit everything. I've used my 3 minutes. The card's up. But now, one tiny little problem. You discussed it. I only talk about good things, and when problems occur, you know who you have to call. You have to call former Mayor Jim Gunning, and he's going to talk a little bit more about the RTD situation.
Thank you, Director Hunt.
I think the board pretty much covered that, but I will quickly just say that, first of all, I want to thank the Metro Mayor's Caucus. I was there at that meeting for their support of Mobility Choice. I think it's an important project, obviously, and I think that's what they were trying to relay. I couldn't have said it better there, Madam Chair, than active patience from Dr. Cog. That's really what we were hoping to achieve. And let me just say the Mobility Choice Board is very sensitive to the partners. Certainly it was unexpected, the vote at RTD, but the normal reach out is taking place. I think a couple of your members know a little bit more about it than I do. I do believe RTD will come back on board. Let me just say the Mobility Choice Board is very sensitive to making sure that Dr. Cog, RTD, and CDOT are partners at the table. They feel those organizations sort of have to be there for this effort to go forward. And we believe that that will happen very soon. They are taking their concerns, as I know this board at one time addressed some concerns. They're taking their concerns very seriously and doing whatever they can to sort of address those. And I believe there will be sort of a resolution, hopefully, sooner than later. I don't have the timeline, but I certainly think the project's going to forward. And I want to thank you for your patience and for your support of this effort, because I think everybody in the metro area believes it's important to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Gunning. Any other takers for public comment? All right. Then we will move on then to our consent agenda, which consists of the minutes of the September 21st meeting. We'd consider a motion. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? The consent agenda is approved, and we'll move on to our action agenda, which will be a discussion of the reallocation of FY 2016 and 2017 stamp funds from a return study.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Hello, everyone. My name is Derek Webb. I'm a regional planner here at Dr. Cog, here to talk to you about the stationary master plan urban center pool of funds within the TIP. But before that, I just want to give you guys a little bit of background. About this time last year, we were working through an allocation of leftover $50,000 from the initial allocation of those funds for the 2016-2017 cycle. During that process, based on board direction, staff went back and kind of reconvened the project selection committee and developed a ranked list of projects that we should work through to offer that $50,000 to. Ultimately, that $50,000 was taken. However, in July of this year, fast-forwarding to July of this year, Dr. Cog's staff received a letter from Thornton notifying Dr. Cog of its intent not to use the funds that were allocated to them for their stamp project. So rather than leaving these funds unallocated, Dr. Cog's staff went back to that ranked list that had already been developed and started looking through the next in line. That happened to be City and County of Broomfield. So we started initial conversations with Broomfield and ultimately received a letter of acceptance for those funds for that project, of course, pending the decision of this board. I should note, too, that Boulder County and RTD were also involved in those discussions, just so that everybody knew what was going on. And Boulder County specifically, there's been an agreement between Broomfield and Boulder County to move the project sponsorship of that project over to Boulder County. That kind of ties right into their current involvement with the State Highway 7 Bus Rapid Transit Feasibility Study that's currently going on. So the two kind of line up pretty well for the continuation of the original Broomfield project. We have in those conversations, we have also received written acceptance of the sponsor change. Boulder County is totally on board to take and run with and sponsor and work with RTD and DRCOG to make this project successful. So it's pretty quick overview. I can stand for any questions, but really the proposed motion is to approve utilizing those return funds from the City of Thornton to fund the City of Broomfield original project, with Boulder County being the sponsor.
Any questions for staff? We have a motion to approve. Do we have a second? We have a second. Further discussion? Director Atchison? Oh, sorry. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? The motion carries unanimously. Thank you. So our next and last action item is the discussion of the TIF second year project delays and appeals.
Thank you. So the adopted TIP policy states project phases that continue to be delayed for a second year are allowed to appeal to the board for a variance to continue if their project is still delayed after October 15th. Contained within attachment one, it outlines the project delays policy for the current TIP. So DRCOG staff has reviewed all of these statuses for projects that were delayed last year for their first year delay. And after confirming this with RTD and CDOT staff, it's been determined that the project phase, there's one project phase that continues to be delayed that was not initiated by October 15th. This project is contained within your agenda. It's the City of Centennial, Smoky Hill and Himalaya Intersection Roadway Operational Project. The project phase that is delayed is the construction phase, meaning the project would have to be advertised to not be delayed any longer. To date, Centennial has progressed with the project, but design plans are still being finalized and advertisement is planned for November. So attachment two contains a letter by Centennial, and it simply states that Centennial wishes to appeal to the board to continue the project. The TIP policy outlines two options for the board on action to take. Number one would be to deny this appeal. This means that the entire $475,000 of federal funds committed to this project would be returned back to DRCOG for eventual reprogramming. Centennial may continue with the project, but it would be with local funds. Option number two would be to allow this variance and apply up to an 120-day extension from October 1st. This puts that the project must be to add no later than January 29th of next year. So staff has been working closely with Centennial staff to advance this project, and our recommendation would be to approve a 120-day variance to allow this project to continue on to advertisement.
Any questions or comments? Mayor Rakowski. Director Rakowski.
Hey, thank you. I move to approve option two as recommended by staff.
Second.
We have a motion and second. Director Pfeiffer.
I have questions. Is anyone here from Centennial? So we have an appeal, but no one from the City of Centennial? None of the staff from Centennial? Because appeals we usually get somebody here. I don't see the letter explaining why we should allow it. The letter from the city was just saying, give me 120 days. If it was amended and the scope was approved on February of 2016, why is it only going to advertisement now? Does staff know? I don't want you to really answer for Centennial, to be honest with you. I'd rather see them here. But you can tell me what they told you.
Well, there was a lot of reworking of the scope after the original scoping took place. And so they had to completely scrap the IGA process, but they did have to almost start the scoping process from scratch and then start over again, along with all the design. So it wasn't until February of 16 until the actual scope was solidified and amended into the TIP.
And so how long does it take to get from that stage to the stage of construction or advertisement?
It's been a very aggressive schedule since February.
I mean, we've had a few communities come here and ask for extensions, and this process is to protect this money for other communities to have the opportunity to get a job done. This is $500,000, and if it's that important, I would expect somebody to be here to justify why $500,000 is being delayed. As many of you know, I've been a little stickler about this subject because I feel the next project could have been done sooner if there wasn't a delay. Now, granted, there's a lot of reasons why, but that's why we want staff or somebody from Centennial to come and explain it so that we can support it. So at this moment, with lack of justification, I will not be supporting this at this moment. Thank you.
Thank you. Director Kanich and then Director Rakowski.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate Director from Arvada's points, and I would make one distinction between the prior applications and this one, which is that we did change the policy, and this request is in conformance with our new policy. The prior couple that we had were when it was kind of gray. We didn't have an extension policy. They were kind of asking to be accepted outside the rule. And if you remember, folks worked really hard to say, let's create a process for this so it's very clear. And this is an application within the process. I too might want to hear from the jurisdiction, but if we never made that a part of the process to say you had to be present, I mean, I don't know if they didn't realize it was on the agenda, you know, if they got confused, if there was a conflict. I mean, we could make assumptions, but I just feel like at this point there was an application made. It conforms with the revision we made to this policy, and the staff is recommending it, which I feel like they know a lot more than we do about the steps that have been taken, the effort that's been happening, and so I appreciate the desire to have them here, but I would hate to turn down an important project that scored well enough to get funded because, you know, we didn't have a policy that said you had to be here, and so I would err on the side of giving them the 120 days and then it's a done. If they don't do it, it's done, because that's what the policy says at this point.
Director Rakowski, and then I assume Director Pfeiffer wants to respond as well.
As a neighbor of Centennial and involved very much with Arapahoe County and Centennial in the reconstruction of I-25 and Arapahoe Road, that's a staff time consent. They have a limited staff, and last week they had the abrupt resignation of the city manager. So there are a lot of things that kind of happened unexpectedly. And I think in the spirit of being somewhat recognizing that we all walk in those sandals sometime, I would plead on their behalf that you give them the 120 days.
Director Pfeiffer.
So because of public record, I don't see the justification. I mean, we should have it all in here. If there's true justification, I would ask that in the future, if staff can make sure that it's not just three paragraphs of saying I want it to go a little bit longer, to actually put some justification and or have the requester here to answer any questions we may have. I'm persuaded by the comments by the mayor and Robin from Denver. So at this time, I'll make the exception this time, but we should, again, I say every time this happens, notice. I know, Mayor, you've been in front of us and then had to come back. I think the same grilling needs to happen just to make sure we're all taking care of the money.
Grilling.
Yeah. Yeah, and Boulder has and a few others, so I'll go ahead and support the motion. This
okay.
One time.
Director Stolzen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a question. I'm comfortable supporting it tonight because there will be the penalty on future projects submitted, so I'm comfortable with it. But is there any reason we have to take action tonight, or could we continue it to the following meeting and ask someone to come and explain the project better to us?
Well, The actual policy says that the hearing, the appeal would occur the next available board meeting, which would be today. Of course, there is that opportunity that by the next board meeting would have already gone to ad anyway, so which we anticipate during the month of November will go to ad. So, yeah, no, I, it's It's, I mean, based on strictly about the policy, it is supposed to be heard tonight.
Yeah. So, and we don't have a formal change in our policy, or I don't hear anybody suggesting it, but I think staff should perhaps relay in the future that there is an expectation of a full justification, ideally delivered in person, for these in the future.
Right. And just so everybody knows, there was, I mean, they knew that it was on the agenda tonight. We had email correspondence as late as this morning with regards to this project. So, yeah.
That having been said, we have a motion and a second on the table. I don't see any further discussion. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion passes unanimously. Thanks for that good discussion, though, and hopefully we'll keep cleaning up our collective acts and moving our projects along.
Point on this before we do leave it entirely. Director Pfeiffer does mention one item of expectation that we may want to include in our notes regarding the policy, and not sure whether we have to formalize that or not, but that we would expect a member from the jurisdiction requesting an extension to actually be present when an appeal is being made.
So just to get a collective sense, would the board like to see that formalized into the policy?
Yes.
All right. So then staff are so directed to bring that policy update.
We'll bring it back to you.
Great. Thank you for that. Next, we'll move on to informational briefings, which starts with the Volkswagen settlement. Doug, are you doing this one?
I will certainly kick it off. Okay. We have a very capable gentleman who's going to give us an update on. I know people have probably been hearing a lot about the Volkswagen settlement and what it means for the state of Oklahoma. We have Chris Klobuchar. What did I say? State of Colorado. 17 years, it's hard to get over it. But I love it here.
Wow.
Well, Oklahoma's getting money too.
They are getting money.
But no, we have Chris Klobuchar here. He's the deputy director of the, golly. What are you, what deputy director of? You got me now.
Hi, I'm Chris Klobuchar. I'm with the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment, Air Pollution Control Division, and I am the deputy for the Air Pollution Control Division.
Thank you. And continue, please.
So it's a pleasure to come speak tonight, and I'm here to talk about the settlement entered by Volkswagen and Audi with EPA and the state of California. I'll give you just very brief background. I'm sure you're generally familiar with this, but Volkswagen, Audi, and Porsche had all been accused of manufacturing vehicles that were able to recognize when they were being tested for emissions. And so they would run in a profile in a manner that allowed them to pass the emissions tests. But then when they were actually being driven on the road, they would run in a different profile, different engine operating parameters, where they would have more horsepower, better gas mileage, better performance, but much higher emissions. And so they did violate federal Clean Air Act standards. And they emitted excess NOx, which is nitrogen oxides. That's a precursor to ozone. It's also a pollutant that can irritate your lungs, causes problems for people with asthma or other respiratory conditions. So they were discovered in 2015, and they've admitted that they did this. So they've entered a partial settlement of some of the claims against them, covering, it's on the slide, I guess, Jettas, Golfs, Passats, Beetles, and the Audi A3, built in model year 2009 to 2015. There are other vehicles that are not covered by the settlement, and the settlement only covers some types of relief. So they can still be liable for penalties. There can be additional claims resolved against them, but they have entered a pretty sizable settlement, a consent decree. There was actually a hearing on this yesterday. The consent decree does not take effect until it's approved by the court. So the court held a hearing. They'd already solicited public comments to get people's reactions to that. The judge did not rule one way or the other, said that he was strongly inclined to approve the settlement, and we anticipate that there will be a final order within a week or so. So there are three parts to the settlement. The first part is about $10 billion to buy back affected vehicles or terminate the leases early or there is an option where the company could come up with a procedure to repair them. That would have to be approved by EPA. But this is directly between the customers, the car owners, and the companies. So if people own these cars and they wish to turn them in, they will get a payment plus some additional cash for their troubles, and that adds up to about $10 billion. The second part of the settlement is a $2 billion nationwide investment to support zero-emission vehicles. California gets about $800 million of this. They were one of the named plaintiffs in the lawsuit, and they also have more of these cars than other states. So the remaining $1.2 billion would be divided among the other states. The companies have a lot of discretion over where this money is spent. So there are some categories established for how the money is spent. It must be spent on either electric or hydrogen charging stations or fueling stations, spent on electric vehicles themselves in order to give people access to them, or spent on education and outreach. So it's in those three broad categories. But as long as they're spending the money within those categories and they have to submit a plan to EPA about the cost, they can pick where that money is spent. So we are, the state is reaching out to the companies to make the case that they should spend a fair share of that money in Colorado. But that is really up to the companies exactly where they make those investments. The third part of the settlement, which I'll talk about the most tonight, is an environmental mitigation trust. And so this is another $2.7 billion that will be distributed to the states, and it's meant to offset the excess emissions. And so it will be used for a specified list of eligible projects, but generally speaking, the intent is to either replace or repower medium-duty and heavy-duty trucks and buses, and also some other types of transportation-related equipment, such as forklifts, railroad switchyard locomotives, and airport ground equipment. So these would be power carts that you plug into a passenger jet while it's on the flight line, so that the lights are on when people are boarding, or heating carts that pump warm air to that plane when it's on the ground in the winter. Those are also eligible. This money, I will say, it has to be used to replace these vehicles, meaning you have to kill an old truck or an old bus and actually destroy the engine so that it can't be driven again. And the idea is that by doing that, you would directly reduce emissions. So that's the purpose of this trust. Colorado gets about $61 million, $61.3 million, over a period running between 3 and 10 years. We can't take the money all at once, so there are limits in the first 3 years on how much you can take. We have to draw the money within 10 years or we forfeit the amount that we haven't taken. And then we have a 15-year window to spend it. So at the end of 10 years, if we haven't drawn all the money, or at the end of 15, if we haven't spent it, then it reverts to the trust and would go either to other states or to the federal government for them to spend. So we'll make sure that we get all $61 million. Next slide. So the purpose of the trust, it's designed to reduce emissions of nitrogen oxides where these affected vehicles were owned or driven. And there is a requirement that we need to describe how our projects, how the work that we're doing and the way that we're spending this money will actually mitigate the impact of excess emissions in communities that have historically borne a disproportionate share of the adverse impacts of such emissions. So a little bit of legalese straight from the trust. This leaves some ambiguity in my mind. Often we talk about disproportionate impacts, and we're talking about low-income communities. And we can interpret the trust that way. So we could steer projects toward communities that have higher concentrations of warehouses or buildings where these trucks would be coming and going, a lot of traffic from heavy vehicles. And those might be low-income or minority communities. Another way to interpret this trust is to say that the entire ozone non-attainment area in the Denver Metro and North Front Range has been disproportionately impacted by NOx emissions. And that is because NOx is a precursor to ozone. Ozone is not emitted directly. It is formed in the atmosphere when you have a chemical reaction between nitrogen oxides and volatile organic compounds, which would be if gasoline evaporated, and that smell, those are volatile organic compounds. Those two react in the presence of sunlight, and they form ozone. So I think it would be very defensible for us to take the position that the entire ozone non-attainment area has historically borne a disproportionate share of the adverse impacts of such emissions. And I would also point out that that is where most of these VWs and Audis have been driven in Colorado. So there are about 9,000 of these vehicles statewide. 6,000 or 6,500 are in the counties where the ozone non-attainment area is located. Another county that has a pretty high population, actually the most VW and Audis in the state, is Pueblo. They're not part of the non-attainment area, but they are certainly a populated area, and it would make sense to spend money there. They've got a large number of these vehicles. The money is available statewide, so everyone is eligible. Public and private fleets statewide are eligible to apply for this money. I will say that there are a number of counties with less than 10 of these vehicles. I think there are a couple with no vehicles. So these also tend to be more rural counties where the air quality is better. So the Department of Public Health, the Air Pollution Control Division, is approaching this with the intent to maximize air quality benefits. We will look at the emission reductions you can get from the money that you're spending, depending on the type of project and what you're replacing these trucks with. We'll also look at the air quality in the area where the project is proposed, and whether it's an area that has historically borne a disproportionate share of these impacts. So that's the purpose of the trust. And here's a list of the projects that are actually eligible. I kind of alluded to these already, but we can go through them one by one. So large local freight and port drayage trucks. Obviously, we don't have ports, but these would be local freight vehicles. So we're not trying to replace over-the-road trucks that would be driving to Florida. We want to replace the ones that you see driving around making deliveries to warehouses or grocery stores or Home Depot or wherever, carrying heavy loads. Also, medium-duty vehicles, the class 4 through 8, school buses, shuttle buses, and transit buses. These are attractive because transit buses tend to be on the road all day long. They start and stop a lot, and so you tend to get more emissions when a bus is starting up and you see the black smoke coming out of the stack. So that's an eligible project. Also, with school buses, you know, kids can spend, especially if you're in a more rural area, you can spend an hour or two a day on a school bus, and a lot of the pollutants, can't give you a percentage, a fair amount of the pollutants tend to work their way into the cabin where the kids are sitting, so replacing those has benefits. There are some other programs that already exist to upgrade school buses, but nonetheless, this would give us a separate pot of money to replace these buses. Railroad freight switchers. There are two rail yards in Colorado, so these would be the locomotives that move cars around the rail yard and link them up into longer trains. Medium-duty local freight trucks. Forklifts. We're still trying to get in touch with the forklift industry to reach out to them. The airport ground support equipment, which I mentioned, and I shouldn't forget, light-duty zero-emission vehicle supply equipment. So we can spend a portion of the money, up to 15% of the money, to install electric charging stations or hydrogen fueling stations for passenger cars, light-duty vehicles. So that's a little bit different. You don't have to replace a vehicle with that. We would just entertain projects to build out this infrastructure. Couple of other categories that are maybe a little bit less relevant. There's the option to use this money as a state matching fund for DERA, the Diesel Emission Reduction Act. This is the program I mentioned that lets us retrofit and upgrade school buses. That is mostly done with federal money, but the states can match that money. Because this money coming from VW is private, it's not federal money at all, it could be used as a state match for this DERA program. I don't know if we'll do that, but it's possible. And finally, some admin costs. So that's a rundown of the projects that are eligible. We talk about the types of vehicles that can be used, the new ones that you would buy to replace the old ones. Clean diesel, I don't think this is on the slide. Clean diesel vehicles can be used to replace the old ones. You can use a compressed natural gas vehicle. It could be propane. It could be electric. Electric vehicles are attractive to my division because they have zero emissions. Obviously, there's some emissions to generate the electricity. But once the vehicle's on the road, it has zero emissions. And so you get multi-pollutant benefits. You're not just reducing the NOx that drove this complaint in this lawsuit. You're also reducing particulates, sulfur. Diesel has some sulfur in it. and you're reducing carbon dioxide or volatile organic compounds. So if people are buying more light-duty passenger cars because now there are more charging stations, the gasoline in those vehicles can evaporate and contribute to ozone. You're also reducing that. So there are benefits of electric vehicles. And there are also some special provisions with a replacement bus or truck. If you buy an electric bus, you can also use some of this money to pay for the charging station for that bus. And this would be a larger, more heavy-duty charger than you'd see for passenger cars. There are different reimbursement rates depending on whether it's a private fleet or a government fleet. With a government fleet, the trust can, doesn't have to, but it can fund 100% of the costs of the replacement vehicle. With a private fleet, there are some different reimbursement levels depending on whether it's diesel or natural gas or electric that you're buying. We haven't made any decisions about how the money would be spent, so I don't know that we would fund 100% of the cost of these projects, but the trust would allow us to do that. Let me talk a little bit about the timeline. Court is expected to approve the settlement this fall, is what it says on the slide. I think today or yesterday we learned it might be as early as next week. After they approve the settlement, there's still some more administrative steps to go through. The trust has been drafted, but there's an opportunity for it to change. It has to go to the Department of Justice as well as VW and Audi in California to be finalized. They have to appoint a trustee, which would be a law firm or a bank, to administer the trust on a nationwide basis. The trustee has to accept. So there are steps to go through. I think it would be sometime next spring, first half of 2017, before the trust is really in effect and funded. And that will establish what's called the trust effective date. Once the trust is in effect, there are some subsequent deadlines. We have to send in an election saying that we wish to participate. We've already talked about this with the governor's office. The state intends to participate in the trust. We elect to become a beneficiary. There's an opportunity for others to object. Then we're notified, assuming we're approved. We're notified that we have been designated as a beneficiary. And we have to file a plan saying in general terms how we would spend the money. That would take us through the fall of 2017. I think funds would be available to the state, to my organization, at the end of 2017, and then we can start to distribute them to applicants, to people who have applied for the funding. You can go to the next slide. So we don't yet have a process set up for local governments or private fleets to apply for money. We are developing that process now. We're conducting some public outreach, including tonight, about how that should be done. And we want to solicit comments on how the money should be spent, as well as how we solicit and review and approve applications. But I expect that sometime in the spring we would be able to lay out a plan for how we would get these applications and review them. In the summer of 2017, we would start to receive applications and score them so that we are ready, as soon as the trust money is available, we're ready to send in a project to the nationwide administrator, nationwide trustee, and request the money. So we do want to be ready to go with projects lined up as soon as the dollars are available. My agency is working with CDOT and the Energy Office to conduct this outreach. We're going to try to set funding priorities. So I've touched on some of these questions already. We need to set the priorities for how we spend the money. My approach to it, you know, because of our agency's role, is to maximize air quality benefits. But there are still a number of factors that you'd want to consider. So we want to look at the different types of projects and the emission reductions that you get from each type of project, as well as how much they cost. And there are different ways to approach these. So let me just throw out a couple of examples. You could use the money to replace as many vehicles as possible. That would lead you towards clean diesel, because they're much less expensive, they're available, you can roll them out quickly, and you could replace old vehicles with new ones that would reduce emissions. Another way to look at that is to think you're replacing vehicles that would at some point be replaced anyway. And so maybe that's not the best use of your money, even though you're getting more vehicles off the road sooner. Another option would be to lean towards electric, or I guess potentially hydrogen fuel cell vehicles. Lean towards electric vehicles. They're more expensive, but as I said, each one has zero emissions when it's running, and it has the possibility that it could accelerate the adoption of zero emission vehicles, leading to greater emission reductions down the road, even after the $61 million is spent. So that's a question that we're soliciting comment on, and I would solicit comments from you as well, either tonight or in writing, about which one of those is a better approach. Here's another question about principles for how you spend it. Where do you spend the money? So as I mentioned, the ozone non-attainment area has been impacted disproportionately by NOx emissions, but the money is eligible to be spent statewide. So there will be questions about the geographic allocation of this money. There will be questions about whether it goes to public fleets or private fleets, or small businesses. Should we have some sort of preference for a small business? These are all questions that we're soliciting comment on, and we'll consider them internally over the next few months. But we want to go through a process that's public and transparent so that when we do award money, and I'm presuming we'll have more applications than we can actually fund, we want people to at least have known what the criteria are before they submit the project and not feel like the process was rigged at the end of the day. So we're doing that outreach right now. We are trying to contact interested organizations as well as fleets and people who might actually benefit from the money and receive some of the funds. So if you go to the next slide, I think, yeah, we have info on our stakeholder meeting scheduled for the 7th of November at the Department of Public Health and Environment, which is in Glendale, Colorado, and South Cherry Creek Drive, from 9 to 11:30 a.m. It will be webcast. We'll also have just a call-in phone option. We want to talk about the terms of the trust and give people an opportunity to come up and give public comment at the microphone. And what we're hoping to do there is let people understand the terms of the settlement and get their feedback on how we should implement this. We are also soliciting comments. We've published a request for comment with a number of questions that essentially all boil down to that same question: how should the money be spent? But different different details about that question. And that information is available on our website. You really can't read the word, but I guess we don't even have the website printed on the slide. It's colorado.gov/CDPHE/VW. So we do have more information available. Yeah, it is printed there, but very tough to read. Sorry about that. We have an address for people to submit comments as well, email comments, and it's cdphe.commentsapcd@state.co.us. If it helps you remember, CDPHE, Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment, .commentsapcd, Air Pollution Control Division, at state.co.us. Those are some of the things we're soliciting comments on, but we do have a longer list online. And does anyone have any questions about the settlement?
I think looks like we have one, Director Rakowski, and then Director Cernanek.
What's the cutoff for written comments?
Great question. November 21st is the, we're requesting comments by the 21st. We can still consider them if they come in later. There's no regulatory deadline that says we can't consider them, but they'll be more useful if they come in by the 21st.
I would like to hear from Director Cernanek, but then I have a proposal after there is discussion for a motion, which I will formulate.
Okay.
And while Director Rakowski is formulating his question, thank you, Chris. Is it possible to encourage other recipients of similar funds to do things that impact the transport that gets dumped on our front range that impacts our ability to comply with the air quality requirements?
That's a great question. One way to do that would be cooperating with other states. And in fact, we've been contacted by Oklahoma asking if we would
coincidentally
they're getting about $10 million, asking if we would cooperate with them to promote projects to buy large heavy-duty natural gas vehicles, and there could be benefits to that. If you look at the heavy-duty vehicles, it's really not feasible to use electric motors there. They just take too much power. So CNG makes sense for that sector. So that would be one way to cooperate with others. But overall, I think what will happen is we will have to see what projects come in. People will come to us and propose a project where they say, we have this many buses we want to replace, we think it will cost this much money, and here's how it fits within the terms of the settlement, here's how it promotes air quality, please pick our project. And we'll need to have a way to score those.
I'm going to insert myself and then see if anybody else wants to say anything. Former Dr. Cog, were you in the queue before? Am I skipping you, not you? No, okay. You were making a joke. I couldn't tell if you wanted to talk or not.
No, so my suggestion was maybe clean air light rail for the Boulder line.
Well, I guess I don't need to say anything. So, actually, I will. I was going to note that former Dr. Cog board chair, Will Tour, had put together a white paper that I'm happy to share. I just got a copy of it. And his organization had done an analysis and a proposal that basically concludes that we would maximize air quality benefits in the non-attainment area by using the full 15% available for fast charging electric vehicle fast charging stations along our major highways that we just mapped at the stack, which would be statewide benefit, but then using the rest on electrification of the transit buses. Mm-hmm. And that, because the point you made about moving to zero emission vehicles, I'm curious if you'd had a chance to look at that analysis and had any comments on that.
I saw a brief email that Sweep circulated that spoke about that. It didn't have a lot of detail, so I'm not sure if it's exactly the same one that you're referring to. But I have been speaking with Will Tour about their proposal, and also speaking with RTD about a similar concept. So I do think there are benefits to that. Those buses run all day long. They're also very visible, and so it would let people see that you can use electric vehicles in this commercial application, and they would work. Some of this is happening already. You're probably aware that RTD is getting electric shuttles for the 16th Street Mall ride, and those are pretty capable. They are also expensive, so it costs about $1 million for each shuttle and the charging equipment that goes with it, but it can run all day long. That's important for them to be able to operate all day long without stopping to charge. And so that is coming. That, separate from this VW money, that is coming. But RTD has suggested that they would electrify a conventional route, maybe the Colfax route or First Avenue Leesdale route, and have some different equipment, larger, heavier duty buses, but run them on those very visible lines and use money from this to pay for that. That's eligible. It's something that we will consider, and they plan to submit comments to us, and I'm sure next summer they will request money for that project. So be premature for me to say one way or the other whether that's something we would approve, but it's eligible and it has some appeal. I imagine that other transit agencies may look at that, either electric, or if electric buses don't work for their situation, then CNG or at least cleaner diesel.
Director Graves.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can we actually go back in the presentation when you start outlining the various funding sources, one of which was the – okay, stop right there, actually. So I'm actually very interested in the $2 billion investment for zero-emission vehicles, and if you could give a bit more detail around what the state is doing to express an interest there, because that to me is really an additional bonus opportunity beyond the allocation of $61 million for the state.
That's an excellent question. So there's $1.2 billion that goes to everywhere except California. If that were allocated using just the same percentages that they did for the other trust, the $2.7 billion trust, based on the number of vehicles, Colorado's share would be about $31 or $32 million. Don't know whether VW and Audi will choose to spend it here, because again, it is in their discretion. But we are in contact with the government relation folks from each of those companies. They're the ones who are coordinating with states about how that money will be spent, and we are preparing information to submit to them to show that this is a good market, that it's attractive, and try to draw that money here. So we're working with the Energy Office, with NREL, with the City of Denver, and specifically Denver Environmental Health, As you know, they went through the Smart City Grant application and were a finalist but did not win. Many of the projects that are included in that grant application would be eligible for funding under this $2 billion investment. So we're collecting that information to highlight that and provide it to the company and encourage them to bring that money here.
Well, first, thanks for the update about how Denver Public Health and Environment is involved, because I was not aware. But I would also say that if there's anything more collectively Dr. Cog or the members of this room could strengthen that appeal to Volkswagen, I think everybody here would be all in.
Yeah, like a commitment to purchase VW and Audi and Porsche vehicles.
Yeah, I understand.
Preferably Porsche vehicles, for the record.
I understand that Mayor Hancock recently committed to buy, I think, 200 electric vehicles for the Denver fleet over the coming years. I don't know the time frame, but commitments like that would matter. And if you have information like that, please pass it to me, and we'll certainly include that.
I had one question. We had received a spreadsheet. I think it was Terry Whitmore from North Front Range had given out a spreadsheet of Blackmore. Wrong, Terry. By county, the number of VWs by county. And if her information was correct, it was El Paso, not Pueblo, that had the huge, the largest.
I'm sorry, I misspoke.
Yes. Okay. Right. So right. They had like 15% of the VWs in Colorado, El Paso. But if you add up all of the Dr. Cog counties, we have over 50%. So, okay. So.
You're correct.
Okay. So I'm going to keep us moving along. This is a really important topic. So, Director Rakowski?
I have a motion. I would strongly recommend that Dr. Cog provide written comments to the board, Colorado Department of Health, and I would base those comments on former Chair Will Tor's analysis of the 15% for charging stations, which I think are the real long-term benefit, and also work with RTD on the transit for the area of our attainment issues.
So do we have a second?
Second.
We have several seconds. Further discussion on that?
You said something about going back and retrofitting school buses. How much would the cost of that be?
We have for the last several years, we've had a grant where we spend about $200,000 a year retrofitting buses.
That's what I thought.
I do not recall the number of buses that we retrofit. I want to say it's a few dozen each year. What that involves is putting on some filtration systems on the crankcase to filter particulates out of the oil, as well as a catalyst. I think that's probably in the range of $10,000 a bus, but I may be remembering that wrong.
Ooh, that's even cheaper. So there's 178 school districts, and if you were to retrofit at least one bus for each school district, that would maybe start to make that whole negative factor feel a little bit better. Just saying, from a school board member, just saying, okay? But that's a thought, because they're on the road.
They are, certainly are.
Other comments, discussion? All right, so we have a motion and a second on the table around providing comments. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? The motion carries. Look forward to receiving a letter from us. Thank you so much for coming. All right. Then moving on to our annual roadway traffic congestion report.
Good evening. I'm Robert Spotts, a transportation planner here at Dr. Cog. You should all have in front of you the 2015 annual report on roadway traffic congestion. And this is attachment F in the agenda and page 60 in the PDF. So this report is part of our federally required congestion mitigation program. We've been doing these reports since 2006. And one of its principal efforts is to monitor the vehicle miles traveled, or VMT, in the region. So we use a spreadsheet-based database to create this data. And then it's used, among other things, besides creating this report, for the tip and the long-range RTP. So since we've been doing this report in 2006, some trends have emerged, including traffic congestion is slightly worse than it was back in 2006, and that's primarily due to just a growing population in the region. To counteract that growing population, we've added a lot of transit options. There's been far more interest in walking and biking in the region, and greater access to real-time information such as using Waze or Google Maps and variable messaging signs from CDOT. So this graph shows total VMT in the region in the blue line and VMT per capita in the dashed red line. So as you can see, it grew pretty steadily through 2006. It plateaued for a good long while there through 2011, and recently has been starting to grow. In fact, the rate has been increasing for the last 4 years. From 2014 to 2015, we have saw a 4% increase, which is the largest increase of VMT we have ever seen. Well, since the 90s, I should say, the largest raw growth in VMT ever. Because of that, VMT outpaced the growth of population for the first time since 2006, and as a result, VMT per capita rose for the first time in a distinguishable way. As you can see, our MetroVision target is 23 VMT per capita, so VMT heading the opposite direction is not ideal. So we've gathered this information. We know VMT did increase, and we took a look around and tried to determine what could have been the contributing factors to that VMT increase. Kind of the headline is our economy is booming. We're getting a lot more people coming here, and a booming economy means a lot more people driving around on the roads, whether that's driving to jobs or just having more opportunities to shop, et cetera. We've also seen decreased fuel costs over the last few years, so driving has become more affordable. We've seen behavior changes, whether that's the millennials who are entering later in a workforce and driving more, whether that's people, you know, switching behaviors based on the economy or fuel changes. And then we've seen increased commercial vehicle traffic. I'm just going to ask, how many of you have had a package delivered to your house in the last 2 weeks? You think if I asked that question 10 years ago, you would have said the same thing? Yeah. I told them yesterday, but I looked at my Amazon history, and I've had 128 orders from Amazon.com in the last 6 months. So that's embarrassing, and yeah.
You're probably a prime customer.
I'm a prime customer. I was ordering things back here, actually, while I was waiting. No, I wasn't. this graph shows kind of as a proxy for economic activity in the Denver region, the unemployment rate for Colorado. And in the last 4 years, you can see the unemployment rate has gone down significantly while VMT has kind of ticked up. This one shows the average fuel cost, so the annual average fuel cost. And again, you see over the last couple years, particularly between 2014 and 2015, there was a sustained decrease in fuel costs through that entire year as VMT was going through this large increase. Another proxy measure, we're seeing a large growth in more affordable or higher efficiency vehicles. So electric cars alone, it's not a significant number at all, but it's a 50% increase from 2014 to 15 of the electrical vehicles on the road. And that's there's additional hybrids out there, and just fuel economy in general is getting far better. Again, just making the cost of operating a vehicle more affordable. Those 128 orders over my last 6 months are directly responsible for this growth in urban truck VMT as we're seeing more urban smaller delivery trucks and others driving around on our roadways. So there's all these external factors. What we can do as planners to slow this VMT growth, we can offer more mobility choices, influence land use decisions to create shorter trips, support carpool and vanpool and teleworking, things that our Way to Go program does, offer travel demand management services like there are all over the region, and then there's real-time traveler information. So this is probably the last report we're going to use specifically this spreadsheet-based model, because we have new methodologies that are going to be available to us because of the use of big data. We've recently gained access to INRIX data through CDOT, and additionally it looks like we're going to get HERE data, H-E-R-E, because it's another major source of data. We're talking about billions and billions of data points, vehicles driving down the roadway, to see congestion in real time or for specific time periods. For the past 4 or 5 years, we've been gathering this data, or this data has been gathered. As one example, this is kind of a lot to look at, but you're looking at C-470 from Kipling to I-25. So those little green signs are kind of the exits around there. And then from left to right on each one of those graphs is the time of day. So on each one of them, you can kind of see the AM period in red and the PM period in red. And you can kind of just pick out some patterns when you're looking at these graphs when it's displayed graphically like that, just to highlight one. So between 2014 and 2015, it's not, you know, it's not maybe the most statistically significant thing, but you can see that typically in September in 2015, the PM peak around when you're entering Santa Fe or exiting the Santa Fe exit is a little bit worse. Speed slowed down there year over year. Another really exciting application is, this is a speed graph. I'm sorry it's a little difficult to see, but it's a speed for US 36 between Boulder and Foothills Drive and I-25. And what you can see is this is February 2012, 14, and 16. The blue line's 2016. And you can see immediately after those managed lanes open that there was a great reduction in delay around those peak periods. Some key metrics just to point out, you know, this, what this report does is kind of look at the average congestion on any given day, but there's 64,000 crashes happening every year in our region or in the previous year, and they cause even more severe delay, and it's much more unpredictable. About a fourth of the region's roadways have severe congestion over 3 hours every day. On average, every resident spends about 37 hours of congestion delay per year. And if you're going somewhere in the peak, it's going to take you about 24% longer than if you were going in the off-peak time period. We'd like to wrap these presentations up with Dr. Cog's 3 A's, how to avoid congestion, adapt to it, and then ways we try to alleviate congestion as well. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thanks for that. Questions, comments? Director Cernanek.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With regard transit use, is there any modeling that you do along that line that would say, say we went to a zero fare basis so that the use of transit was actually a zero cost? And because I notice as I ride transit that a lot of folks are on some sort of passes either from students or through employment. And those seem to be the predominant users. Would that make an impact in the vehicle miles traveled? And there's a second question, so I'll get them both out. Since there's, as Chris indicated earlier, zero emission with electric vehicles, but you're seeing an increase in that, when does that become of not a great concern and we shouldn't be as concerned about vehicles mile traveled in electric vehicles?
So it's been a while since we've done scenario planning, but at the beginning of our 2040 RTP process, we did do scenarios, and one of those scenarios did go through a, it was a kind of a kitchen sink type of scenario, but one of the factors was free transit ridership, and certainly did make an impact, pretty much the largest impact in terms of transit ridership.
Well, let me just add, I'm glad Robert mentioned the scenario planning, because I think it is a direction we're going to be doing more of, and I tell you the reason why. We have a travel demand model we have in the past, activity-based model that was, it was kind of like the Titanic. It took a long time for that sucker to run, and we're in the process now recalibrating the model and speeding it up. We're talking about, you know, something that used to take, you know, a week to run, we're going to be able to do it in hours. So that will provide us with a lot more flexibility and latitude to be able to run scenarios.
You just mentioned something for higher expectations.
In regards to the second part of your question, we're always going to care about vehicle miles traveled, regardless of emissions, because they lead to congestion. You know, and we're at a tipping point with congestion where the more people on our roads, you know, it's not like one-to-one ratio. Congestion gets a lot worse when you add more people. And the other part, as Deborah mentioned yesterday, if zero emission vehicles are also not contributing to the Highway Trust Fund. This is not going to the pump, so we're having less money to spend to solve those problems.
Director Roth.
So I mentioned this at RTC, but I think it bears repeating. So we're in the middle of revamping our comprehensive plan in the city of Aurora, And to give you perspective, we're about 3 or 4 months into an 18-month plan. And one of the things right now is citizen engagement and community meetings. To date, about 1,300 citizens have reacted to a survey of things that are important to them. And what the consultants tell us is that never in the history before have these two items been even in the top 20. And not only in Aurora, but in other municipalities that they've been working with around the country, two things that are consistently now in the top five are access to bicycle and walking. So there is, I think, a dynamic shift that's taking place that's changing people's attitudes towards it, and we're seeing it here, and our consultants are seeing it across the country. So I think from that standpoint, you know, what we're seeing is very encouraging.
Thanks for sharing that. Director Sullivan.
Could I ask you to go back to your graph that it's on page 5 in the handout? It has the blue spike around the all trucks urban. Could you just go over that spike one more time for me, please?
I tried to speed through this one, but so this is first of all, this is a national chart, not just Colorado. It's from the Brookings Institute, and it's looking at relative growth for each of these modes. The three modes are, or I guess, items. One is urban population, so relative to the population in 1966, you know, there's been about 100% growth. You can see it. Conversely, truck traffic, urban traffic, I should say, has gone, you know, say it was 0.25% in 1966, it's 800% more today. So that means it's gone from 0.25% to, you know, 2% or so, roughly speaking, on urban roadways.
So this is your Amazon purchases?
Yes. So
he's personally responsible.
So you can see in 2006, there was kind of this, that's kind of the birth of Amazon, and heavy-duty internet ordering was around that time. It dipped because of the Great Recession, theoretically, and now, you know, unfortunately, this only goes through 2012. So the last 3 years, we'll see. It may have returned to the previous or not.
Okay. I just wanted to point out, it seems like a possible policy opportunity. I don't know if, you know, that there's a lot of convenience in having things delivered to your home. I live near the mountains, so it's pretty common for us to have things delivered to a central location and have to go and pick it up. So I don't know if those types of policies are being considered, or taxes on home delivery convenience might offset or provide some funding for some of these emission issues it's creating.
Great. Any final comments? Thank you so much. Really interesting data. Appreciate you sharing that. Having heard it twice now at RTC as well, it's very provocative, and as Doug Rex would say, it's a call to action. So, okay, so moving right along, we're coming down the home stretch. I don't want to shortchange the committee reports, though. I'll start quickly on STAC. We received an update on Policy Directive 14 performance measures. Probably the one that stuck out in my head is that we're going the wrong direction in safety, and we're seeing an increase in fatalities and accidents. And about a third of them are a result of people not wearing seat belts. So that could be something that a state policy focus to look at in the future. There's a lot of talk about how to spend Senate Bill 228 funds. Over half are going to Central 70, but they're still going to be in the neighborhood of $140 million for other projects. So the different regions are looking at putting together their project lists, and I think that CDOT's interested in having sort of tier one of those project lists. Well, I'm mixing up the 10-year development plan and the Senate Bill 228 project list, but nonetheless, the 228 projects need to be ready to go, shovel ready by December 2018, and there's going to be some discussion about geographic equity. So I don't know what the process is in the DRCOG region for making sure our lists are together. I know Region 4 is having a meeting soon, but that's an important process to make sure we have ready to go, because that's going to be a focus. And then National Highway Freight Program, they're continuing to move forward with that and look at project selections, the next phase of that. Anything else you would add on STAC?
No.
Okay. Enough on STAC. Let's move to Metro Mayor's Caucus. Director Atchison had to leave. I don't know if there was more to add. Any mayor here other than what we heard on Mobility Choice Blueprint? Okay. Sold. Metro Area County Commissioners, we had an excellent meeting hosted by Denver on affordable housing and what folks are doing around the region on that. So if anybody's interested, Robin Kanich can get you the whole stack of materials they produce for that. Director Cernanek?
Yes.
Tripoli?
Based on the wonders of the calendar, Director Sanchez Warren provided a report at last meeting on the September meeting, and our October meeting is not until Friday, but I did want to mention that as she may have talked about in her report, one of the things that happened at the September meeting was regarding advocacy training for our advisory committee members, and I would venture to open that up for folks that are interested in advocacy training. It's, I believe, tentatively scheduled for November 4th, and they can either contact Director Sanchez Warren or her assistant Mindy if you have an interest in the particular details for that. And to remember, at least with regard one of the issues in trying to extend senior independent living at home, which is the most efficient cost approach, both for what the individual would prefer, which is independent living as long as possible, and impact on other programs like Medicaid as well as Medicare. That's the best approach. Right now, Colorado is hurt by the current provision of hold harmless. What that does is it protects particularly eastern states that are not growing in their senior population, whereas Colorado has seen a significant increase in the senior population because of all the boomers that have moved here, aren't at the most trouble yet, although Jayla would probably say we're in difficulty, but it will get worse as our boomers move to frailty years, meaning that the threshold is not age 65, but it's age 75. And we're currently receiving an under allocation, so it's unequitable relative to some of the states that are protected under the hold harmless provision. So good question to ask both Senate and House candidates as to what is their position on the Older Americans Act.
Thank you, Director Cernanek. Shakti is not here, but the report from the RAC is that they just had a committee meeting to discuss the VW settlement and what their recommendations would be on that. Which takes us to E-470. Director Rakowski.
Very briefly, we had the big budget meeting, which went well, and involved all the stakeholders and alternates, and construction is underway and a little bit ahead of schedule.
All right. All right, Bill Van Meter, take it home with RTD.
Well, I see the meeting scheduled to last till 9:15, so that gives me a 12-minute update. Very quick update.
Is it at your peril, or
at my peril, exactly. I have a very quick update. The Fast Tracks Monitoring Committee received an update regarding the University of Colorado G-Line, I almost said. The G-Line at their meeting earlier this month, and as has been reported widely in the press yesterday evening and today, we also held a press conference. Dave Genova held a press conference yesterday to discuss the University of Colorado A line, the G line, and the I-225 Aurora, or alternatively called the R line, and the status of those projects, as well as a number of other items at RTD. So, in the interest of being short, we are still targeting, I'm trying to pick the words carefully and reiterate how it was presented at the press conference, we are still targeting a fall 2016 opening date for the G line. It will not open until our FRA waiver on the University of Colorado A line at the at-grade crossings and those issues are resolved. So we do not have a date for the G line opening to Arvada and Wheat Ridge. We also don't have a date yet for the I-225 or Aurora line, but Dave Genova did announce yesterday during the press conference that he intends to announce information, presumably the opening date for that project, to our board next Tuesday night. So those are that's the update on the two of the remaining five projects we are opening this year. Any questions?
Director Peck.
Bill, thank you for that. Do you have any information on the Fast Tracks Internal Savings Account or FISA that was brought up at the RTD meeting?
Yes, so thank you for that prod. just last evening at the Finance and Administration Committee meeting, not Fast Tracks Monitoring, which is why I wasn't on top of it as I should have been, the RTD board considered and recommended in committee advancing to the full board action next Tuesday night a recommendation that in the future, I'll try to word this carefully, any sales and use tax revenues generated by the 0.4% for sales and use tax for fast tracks above what was projected and budgeted in a year, if any sales and use tax revenues come in above that amount, they would be immediately allocated to the Fast Tracks Internal Savings Account, which was a savings account that the RTD Board of Directors established in 2011-ish to fund US 36 Bus Rapid Transit, North Metro to 72nd, and the remaining Fast Tracks projects that aren't fully funded to date. So they took an affirmative action to try to accelerate funding of that FISA account for those purposes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. And any final announcements? Director Pfeiffer, you had something?
Announcement. Speaking of a delayed project, I'll remind some folks, about a year ago, Wheat Ridge came and asked for their trailhead to be extended across Kipling. I just want to say it was completed, and since I did support that and advocated for it, different than my majority of the time on these subjects, Wheat Ridge invited me to come and do a ribbon cutting with them, and it was nice. It was nice to be there and see a project completed that is, you know, very dear for the community and the region, and it was a true sense of regionalism there, and I just wanted to share everyone that project did get completed. Yes, it was delayed, but it was a great event, and it happened last Saturday.
And are you hoping Centennial invites you to there?
Well, my fear, so my fear is they'll put me in the street to cut the ribbon, and I guess no one else will be there.
Director Partridge.
In respects of our executive director's absence, just in privacy, I think we ought to just remember her in our thoughts and prayers. And also, I want to give a shout-out to Interim Director Doug Rex and all the staff, because I think they've been doing a wonderful job in this time, because we know anytime you have somebody that's close to that's undergoing a challenge, everybody in the family is challenged. So, Doug and the staff, thank you very much for doing a great job. Appreciate you.
Well said. All right, good night,
everyone. Colorado.
Oh.
Not Oklahoma.
Colorado. Good night, all.